بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم، الحمد لله رب العالمين، اللهم صل وسلم وبارك على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم. الحمد لله. We're continuing on in the book. We're on page 27. We're on page 27 looking at the topic of Niyaba. Part of this topic of Niyaba is a recognition of time. So one of the principle, really, we can say one of the key aspects of the prophetic mission was actually making us aware of the sacred nature of time. This is something that really has been lost in the modern world by many of us, whereby our time is measured according to like the Gregorian calendar, or according to arbitrary measures that we have. Even our birthdays, for example, we don't really know our Islamic birthdays. We often measure our birthdays, we measure significant events. And when did something happen in our lives? We know it by February or March or April, rather than by the Islamic months, Rajab, Sha'ban, Ramadan, for example. So right now, just give an example, right now, obviously we're in the month of Rajab, mashallah, which is the month of Allah. So we've had 10 days. Today is the 10th day of Rajab. So again, if you perceive time and we see the importance of time, we should now be thinking to ourselves, it's been 10 days of Rajab. How have I done in these 10 days? What's happened to me in these 10 days? Am I now closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Have I increased in my istighfar? Have I increased in my seeking forgiveness? Have I increased in my turning back to Allah? Have I increased in good actions and in yearning for the divine? Have I increased in my salawat? Have I increased in the amount of blessings and salutations and benedictions that I send upon the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam? Have I seen the Rasul this month? I'm 10 days in, they would say, our teacher Sheikh Omar Hussain, he said that if you don't see the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam at least once a week, this way his way said, if you don't see him every week, then that's a sign of insincerity in your da'wah. That you aren't sincere in your calling, you aren't sincere in your da'wah to others if you don't see the Rasul once a week. Why is that? Because the Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he is the gateway for our da'wah. Like we mentioned before, that we are calling people to him. So if we aren't connected to him, then how can we call others to him? This is why the Arbab, the great ones, look at Imam al-Haddad by the end of his life, Imam Ali al-Habashi, they would see the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam permanently in the waking state. So whatever they did, they would have the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam as an example before them. And they would use that example in order to live their lives. They were completely immersed and absorbed in love of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. One of them, he said that, Imam al-Haddad, he said that, if you want to speak to me, then be brief. Yeah, if you want to speak to me, then be brief, and I'll give you a concise answer. I'll give you a satisfactory, concise answer, because he was too engrossed in remembrance of his Lord. He was too engrossed in remembrance of the Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam to be able to even be distracted and be engaged. And you bear in mind, this is who is Imam al-Haddad. They call him the Qutb, that the pole or the master of da'wah and irshad. They say he's the master of calling people to Islam and rectifying societies, communities, people. Yeah, peoples in the larger sense. Umam, civilizations. He's a rectifier of civilization, such that to this day, Imam al-Haddad, who many consider the Mujaddid, the revival of the 12th Islamic century, to this day, how many people do we know? How many that are still entering Islam through his works? They said about Imam al-Haddad, one of the brothers in Dar al-Mustafa, he mentioned, he's from the UK, he said that his wife is a munshida, mashallah, she recites sacred poetry in praise of Allah and praise of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So his wife, she once went to like a prison. She does a lot of work in female prisons. And she went to a prison and they recited like poetry. And you know, they had like a, mashallah, a nice evening, an evening of reviving the soul. And then towards the end of the gathering, she said, like, does anyone have any requests? Do they want to request that I recite any particular poetry or any particular poem? And so there was one lady there. And again, he said that with our narrow-mindedness, with our cultural misconceptions, maybe we might look upon a lady like this who's got, you know, nose piercing, she's got tattoos, she's got a short haircut. So maybe from our narrow-mindedness, we might, due to our weakness of our heart, we might perceive a sense of arrogance towards this, or a sense of ihtiqad, looking down upon people. And what does this woman say? She says, I want to hear qad kafani. And the sister, she said she was really moved, and the people around were really moved because they recognized that the Muslim doesn't fit into a particular box that maybe we have. And they recognized and they understood that this was somebody who had a deep connection to who? To Imam al-Haddad. She had heard and she loved the poetry of Imam al-Haddad all the way in the UK from where he is, you know, 300 years later, in a completely different environment, living in a completely different way. And yet the sincerity of a man who became blind at the age of 5. He never left Tarim his entire life, Imam al-Haddad. He never ever left Tarim. And yet, look at the impact, look at the reach. Like now, literally all four corners of the world. You go to America, you're reciting the poetry of Imam al-Haddad. Yeah, you go to the Far East, Malaysia and Indonesia, millions reciting it. You go to Australia, they're reciting his poem. You go to South America, Brazil, these places, they are reciting the poetry of Imam al-Haddad. Yeah, we met people, subhanAllah, in Dar Mustafa from all four corners of the planet, and then some. Yeah, so they're reciting his poetry everywhere. This is the sincerity of the caller to God. Yeah, somebody who really sincerely calls to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, his impact is profound. Yeah, so inshallah, we should ask ourselves, we're in Rajab, 10 days in, and alhamdulillah, we still have another 19 or 20 days to go. And the culmination of Rajab, of course, is the 27th night, the Laylatul Isra wal Mi'raj, the night of the ascension, yeah, the night journey and the ascension. So we should commit to improvement. Yeah, we should really commit to improvement in months like this. That if we're not going to commit to improvement now, then when will we? And we should have a plan in place of how am I going to improve? How am I going to get better? What am I going to do to increase my love for the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, to improve on my journey to the Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam, to improve and increase my connection to the Quran, to improve and increase my connection to my prayer, my salah, so I can have more khushu, more presence. Yeah, what am I going to do? How am I going to arrive at these goals? Yeah, and the best way, of course, of doing that is to ask Allah. So we should also have times, moments after our prayers in the depths of the night between Maghrib and Isha, before Maghrib. Yeah, different times when we're doing lessons like this, these are blessed opportunities to ask Allah, to really, really ask Allah to place within our hearts a deep desire to fulfill what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the trust that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has placed upon us. So if you turn back to the book, we were looking at this topic of niyaba, some of the meanings of niyaba, of being like a representative or a deputy of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And like we mentioned, for us in non-Muslim lands, by default, just by living in a non-Muslim land, by default, you have become a representative of the Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Whether you like it or not, it doesn't matter whether you chose to, whether you want to, just by being in these lands, you have become a representative immediately. That's the first thing we need to understand. The next thing is, what do we mean by niyaba? There's qualities of niyaba. And we find these qualities in the Quran. When he talks, when he says, لَقَدْ جَاءَكُمْ رَسُولٌ مِّنْ أَنفُسِكُمْ عَزِيزٌ عَلَيْهِ مَعَنِتُمْ حَدِيثٌ عَلَيْكُمْ بِالْمُؤْمِنِينَ رَؤُوفٌ رَحِيمٌ Yeah, so look at these qualities now that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he's deeply concerned. حَدِيثٌ عَلَيْكُمْ is very, very keen for your guidance. This is one of the qualities of niyaba, that the one who's a deputy of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he's very, very keen and eager, and he's striving and he's very, very concerned about other people. Yeah, about helping, assisting, elevating, healing, relieving other people from any type of distress, distress or hardship, whatever that might be, whether it might be financial, whether it might be physical, whether it might be mental, whether it might be spiritual, whatever type of hardship, he is the one who wants to relieve his people, which is the entire world. He wants to relieve them of this hardship. He wants to make people happier, more joyous, more optimistic, better, more improved in every aspect of their life. Yeah, so Aziz alayhi, he's really, you know, aware of what's going on with you. I mean, hadithun alaykum, yeah, bil mu'mineen, that he's very keen to improve people's conditions. Hadithun alaykum bil mu'mineen, ra'ufur rahim. He's gentle, he's ra'uf, and he's merciful. So mercy, like we said, one of the meanings of mercy is extending benefit to humanity. Another one of the meanings of mercy is having love and compassion within one's heart that overflows onto the entire creation. This is the mercy and the gentleness. This is the type of mercy and the gentleness that we are talking about here. And these are the ones who are representative. Another example we find in the Quran, Ya ayyuhan nabiyyu. Now the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam is being directly addressed. It says, Ya ayyuhan nabiyyu, inna arsalnaka shahidan wa mubashiran wa nadhira. That it says that we have sent you as a shahid, as a witness. This is one of the key qualities of niyaba, is to be a witness to the truth. Even if it's against your own selves, that as human beings, as Muslims, we are witnesses to the truth. Yeah, we witness the truth and we are with the people of truth. Even if at times the people of truth might be saying things that the majority of Muslims agree with or don't agree with. It doesn't really matter. We look for truth and we stand with people of truth and uprightness. That's who we stand with. Yeah. So this is the first thing. We are witnesses over others. Yeah. Such that we establish truth and we establish meaning. Yeah. Shahidan wa mubashiran. And he is a giver of glad tidings. He's a giver of glad tidings, of happiness, of joy, of optimism, of beauty, of upliftment, of every possible quality of increase and goodness that you can possibly think of. He gives good tidings that it's going to be okay. Life's actually positive. It's actually, mashallah, not only do we have something to live for, we have a lot to live for. Yeah, and we have a lot to be happy about. What greater happiness can there be than to be able to be connected to the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, and to be able to be close to him, and to have a deep link and love to him, Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. So Mubashir wa Nadhira, and he's also a warner. What is the warning? Part of the warning for us is to warn people of not harming their own selves. Don't take yourselves to destruction, i.e. follow this guidance, because if you don't, there's consequences in the world, which is unhappiness, which is anxiety, which is depression, which is a lack of fulfillment and emptiness within the soul. This is what we have to convey to people, that by doing this, you're actually making yourself unhappy. You're distancing yourself from mercy and love and beauty. Yeah, like now they mentioned, one of the brothers who were mentioning that in the UK with the coronavirus, they said that the suicide rate within the UK has quadrupled. It's quadrupled. Domestic violence, is through the roof at the moment. Domestic violence, oppression towards women and children, well, the weak people within society, is on the increase. We are seeing now rates of, in terms of mental health. And this has been happening. Like we said, the World Health Organization, 2020, they were true to their word. They told us about 15 years ago that 2020, the number one killer in the world is going to be anxiety, depression, these kind of things. And lo and behold, 2020, that's what took place. And it's only increasing now. So this is part of it, is when you're warning people, it's not like, oh, hellfire is coming. That's not what we're talking about. We're talking about warning within a context that impacts people. They understand it. And you say to them, so this is right now, this is affecting your life. You can be happy. You don't have to choose this path of going down a path of difficulty. You can be in communities of love. You can be with families of love. You can have a heart full of love. Yeah, we have to show them this way. And we have to give them examples. Like our teacher, Habib Qadir al-Saqaf, someone asked him about new Muslims, when people enter into Islam. And the same principles apply to anybody really, whether it's a practicing or a non-practicing Muslim or a non-Muslim, yeah, what he said was, he said, a new Muslim, when they come in, he said they need support and they need 30 or 40 people around them. It's not just a matter of that one-to-one support is important, but he said they need to be able to see a community, 30 or 40 people that are visiting them, that are with them, yeah, that are helping them. And that's how they then feel that holistic, and it's different faces every day, different faces. And they mentioned one of the initiatives that they do in Liverpool that's done by some of the sisters there is, when a woman, when she has a baby, they provide food for her for 40 days. They give her food for 40 days. They have a rota, maybe they have 10 sisters or 10 families that are doing it, and they take 4 days each like this, so they rotate it. And they said that they've seen many, many women become Muslim. Many, many women enter Islam just through that, because it's a difficult time. It's a hard, stressful time, and they are seeing help from people, from individuals, from families that are helping them with no connection to them whatsoever. No tribal connection, no family connection. Many of them aren't even from the same city as them. They come from outside and they're just living there. They're helping them purely for the sake, for the love of Allah and His Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. And that shines through. So many of them, and many of them, their faith is strengthened. Muslims, when they see that love, and their faith is strengthened through that. This is what we mean. This is what we mean when we're warning people. We're warning them that you don't want to turn away from this beauty and this goodness. Like one of the students, one of the teachers, that Mustafa Sidi Musa, he said that the reason he became Muslim was because he used to visit people's houses. He went to the houses of the Muslims and he ate with them. And he said he saw love and joy amongst them. You know, like their family life. He saw much of these people, they've got extended family that care and love for them. And one of the things, the faqir coming back from abroad, one of the things, you don't have abroad, you don't necessarily have a family. So coming back here, mashallah, we have 4 or 5 households, aunties and uncles, and we take it for granted. Like, I can go now, well, maybe not right now, but you know, when things are normal, there's no lockdown, I can go to my auntie's house. Yeah, and she's got 5 children. I can go to my uncle's house, he's got 5 children. Yeah, I can go to my cousin's house, she's got children like this. So therefore you part of us. So if you need anything, you have your family there. And then you have friends, like real friends, loyal friends, people who will love you for the sake of Allah and the Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. So nothing else. We have nothing else. The only reason, the only connection we have is that. And therefore you then have this deep, and that is really what gives people joy and happiness. Yeah, that's what we have to warn people that you don't want to miss out on that. This is the warning. Yeah, when you're saying that Prophet came as a warner. Not that there's other meanings, but this is the positive meaning of being the warner that we should take. Yeah, and he was a caller to Allah bi-iznihi, by the permission of Allah. The absolute permission of Allah was given to the Prophet to call up the people to him. This permission was given. And we now are tahta amrihi. We are under his command. We are under the command of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. Our permission to call other people to Islam is from Sayyidina Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. That's why it's very important to have sunnah. We should be connected to scholars who are waratha, who are representatives of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam's mission and his da'wah. And then we take our permission, we take our ijazah, yeah, we take our permission to call others through them, because they have permission from the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. Now, one of the Sheikh Omar Hussain al-Khatib, he was called to Wales. You know, they have the Trodden Path retreat. The first one, which was maybe 2005, 2006, I'm not sure, you know, 10, 15 years ago. He was called to, you know, to come to this retreat. And so he wasn't so sure. He did istikhara. And then he said, I saw the Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam in my dream, and I asked him, asked to go to this far off land, Wales. Yeah, I don't know where Wales is. Asked to go to this far off land, Wales, for 10 days to, you know, to call people to Islam and to teach about this religion. What should I do? The Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said, go and spread this call. And he said, that's why he came. He said, I took permission directly from the Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. That's a rank. Yeah, that's a rank, that's a position that people have. But for us, lesser mortals, it's at least, inshallah, we should try to take permission from people who are linked back in that chain, that connects back to the source. Yeah, this is niaba. This is what gives us our strength. So you mentioned, if you look at the book, he talks about this. So he says, Hayakumullah mal akhbar innakum. So he's saying, you know, may Allah enliven you, you know, what news is there? Wakeifal manatikum lati antum fiha. And how, these are questions. How are the places where we live? Wamatikum al qawli wal amali. And your speech and your action. How is your speech and your action? Wamajalu istish'ari niyaba indakum bidhawq wa tarjama. And how is your perception? How is your understanding of your deputy, you being a deputy? How do you perceive, how do you understand the reality of you being a deputy of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam? That you are a deputy of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. How do you understand that reality? How do you perceive that in terms of dhawq, in terms of tasting that reality, and in terms of your physical, practical, physical following of that? Yeah? How do you practically follow that reality? It's an essential, essential point. How do you follow the reality of the fact that the Prophet is part of our lives? Yeah, and how do we practically implement that? So then he goes and then he says, "Amma istishalu bi dhawq yunhi wa yub'adu ila al-qalb wa istishalu bi tarjama yudhibu ila al-a'mal." So he says, as for your perceiving, your perception of dhawq, of tasting the reality of the Prophet ﷺ, this will cure your heart. This will distance you from sicknesses of the heart. Yeah, that if you connect, you are tasting, experiencing the realities of this religion, the sicknesses of the heart will disappear. And as for you following him practically, this will remove the defects of your actions. Your actions will no longer be defective in their nature. Yeah. وَلَوْلَا الْفَوَائِدَ الْكُبْرَى فِي أَمْرِ الْإِجْتِبَاطِ بِنِيَابِ إِذَوْكِ وَالْعَمَلِ. Yeah. وَالْمُتَرْجَمِ in the بِمَا قَالَ الْمِسْلَ اللَّهُ بَلِقُوا عَنِي وَلَوْ آيَةٌ لِمَا ذُعِينَ عَلَيْهِ. So he's saying that the benefits of this niyaba, the benefits of this niyaba, of this following, come from this statement. The Prophet ﷺ said, convey from me, even if it's just one verse. Now, in other words, we convey as much as we are capable, as much as we've learned, as much as we know, and as much as we have embodied, we convey. Yeah, that could be mentioned many times, but this is a primary aspect. Yeah, the conveyance of the message is a primary concern for every single Muslim. Yeah, it's a primary concern. Then he says, "Leda, ayu waqtin turid an tuballigh ta yakuna laka hablun musilun ila nabi wa babun yudkhiluka alayhi fatuballigha balagan sahihan anhu." Yeah, so now he's saying that anytime you desire to convey, now this becomes a rope, a connecting rope from you directly to the Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So in other words, when we serve the ummah, when we serve creation, when we assist creation, we are serving the Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam. This is one of our teacher Habib Qadim al-Saqaf. Someone asked him, what's the quickest way to Allah? What is the quickest way to arrive at Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to arrive at the divine presence? And he said, the quickest way, the fastest, the easiest way. And this is an answer we need in our lives. What's the quickest way? What's the easiest way to arrive at the divine presence? What's the easiest way to arrive at Allah, to worship Allah and to serve Allah and to be close to Allah? What's the best way to get close to Allah? He said it's through serving the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And if he isn't physically with us, how do we serve him? We serve him through serving creation, through serving humanity. This is the quickest way to get into him. So look, I mean, you look at the boast of the Sahaba. What was it? Look at Sayyid Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, radiyallahu anhu arda, used to carry the sandals of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam under his arms like this. Used to have the miswak. Used to have the water jug the Prophet did wudu with. And this was a boast amongst the Sahaba. MashaAllah, look what he has. He used to walk into the house of the Prophet like he was a family member. Look at Sayyidina Anas, was the hair keeper. He had the blessed hair of the Prophet. He had his sandals. And he used to, even years after the Prophet had passed away, we know he would bring out the hair and show them with pride. Look, I am looking after, I am serving, and I served him in his house for 10 years. Yeah, this was the boast of the Sahaba. And we too can have that fakhr, that honoring. We too can stand on the Day of Judgment and boast, we served the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. How do we do it? Through serving creation. Through serving creation and bringing benefit to creation, we can become of those people ourselves. Yeah, subhanAllah. So the door's open. We should never ever feel that that is closed. Yeah, the door's open, and this is the connection. Yeah, so this is how we are able to enter into the doorway of serving the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam and connecting to him. This is why one of our teachers, Shaykh Yahya, wrote this in America. Someone asked him, they said, what is the greatest sunnah? Yeah, what's the greatest sunnah that we can fulfill? Yeah, it's an important question. Again, it's a question we should think about. Yeah, and he said, from amongst the greatest sunnah, or if not the greatest sunnah, is to create an environment where many other sunnahs can be fulfilled. So to create an environment that facilitates a prophetic lifestyle, that facilitates the enactment of prophetic commands. Whether that be our home, first of all, our house should be a beacon of prophetic light. That our house should have all of the sunnah established: prayer, zikr, salah, Quran, tafakkur, tazakkur, like durus. All of these things should be taking place. We should have Quran being read in our house. We should be remembering Allah. We should be praying in our house. We should be fasting in our house. We should be reflecting upon creation in our house. We should be having lessons in our house. We should have all of these things established within our house. And then some. Our adab, the way we speak with our family members, should be based upon the prophetic way. We should be showing love and compassion for our children. We should be being good to our spouse. We should be putting our spouse first. We should be serving our family around us. All of these types. And the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, when he was in the house, he was in the khidmah of his family. Yeah, all of these things. And then beyond that, in our neighborhood, within our society, our community. Yeah, all of these different things, this establishment of the prophetic environment. Yeah, this is the greatest of all of the prophetic sunnah that we can fulfill. If you are really concerned, inshallah, we have a good opinion that we are people that are deeply concerned with fulfilling the prophetic mission. We are deeply concerned with turning wholeheartedly to the way of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. We really want this. If you really, really, really want to do this, then establish environments that allow for this barakah to flow, that allow for this madad, this help, this assistance from the divine, from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to flow through you, through your houses, through your societies, your neighborhood, your communities. Have established things that many of them now, many of these people, what will they do? MashaAllah, these people who have a concern for the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, they will feed their neighbors once a month. 40 houses around, I'm going to feed everybody. Once a week, the people immediately right now want to go out and give them gifts. See how they're getting on. Give them an ear. How's your life? Yeah, all these types of things. This is what creates a neighborhood of concern and of prophetic love. And then we go beyond that, yeah, to our community. We start establishing things within our masajid, within our community centers, creating spaces where people can come in and feel prophetic love, where this light can be shared. All of these types, this is the greatest sunnah. And this is one. Then another one, he said, another aspect we can say of the greatest sunnah is the sunnah of radical simplicity. The sunnah of letting go of the junk, yeah, of the dust of this world, to let go of that. This is another, many say, this is the greatest sunnah we can fulfill. Because then we have hearts that are now removed from filth of dunya, and hearts are connected to the akhirah. And once you have a heart that's been purified like that, it becomes transitive in its impact. It's able to seize other people and take other people unto Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as well. Yeah. So these are from amongst, if not the most important, of the sunnah. Yeah, these are the sunnah that inshallah we should focus on within our lives. We ask Allah for tawfiq, and we ask Allah for qabool, we ask Allah to accept our acts of worship within Rajab. We have some, if you have any questions here.
Assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum assalam, Sayyidi.
I've got, two things. Number one, I'd like to hear more about Habib Kazim's advice on sort of supporting converts, particularly when he said about, you know, they need access to 30, 40 people. That's, you know, there's a statement that attributed to some of the fuqara that it takes 10 healthy people to make one sick person better. So it's interesting. I'd love to hear more on that. And then secondly, you spoke about Sheikh Omar al-Khatib and the early trodden path doldras. I've got some notes that I've posted into the chat if anybody wants to copy them. From a Q&A from that particular doldra. It was either that one or the second one, but the doldra that he was given idhn to attend by the Rasul in his dream. So he was asked about convert care, and there was some nasiha that he gave, and I've posted it into the chat. I've got it from way back. So
there you go. Inshallah. Fantastic. Barakallahu feekum. That we will definitely leave this chat open for people to be able to take that. Inshallah ta'ala. Even after that, we close or we leave the session open for the barakallahu feekum. So in terms of what Habib Qadir mentioned there. In terms of your first question, Sayyidina, what he was essentially saying is that what can sometimes happen is that people can become sort of isolated in communities, or people are just seeing one or two people, and it becomes difficult for those one or two people to take on the job of looking after someone else in and of itself. And also they're not seeing the variety of people, so they don't feel part of a community. So he said they need to be seeing different faces. They should have different people coming in and out of their lives all the time. Yeah, and therefore, as he mentioned this figure, 30 or 40, he said, when you're able to do that, it becomes a holistic way. Because part of, as we know, like for example, different adhkar, when we recite different invocations, they have a different type of madad that flows. We know that when you recite in the Quran, and then we say, la ilaha illallah, why do we not just recite the Quran all the time? It's the best of dhikr, obviously. But different adhkar give different flows of barakah. In the same way, different people bring different things to the table. And some people, like we know, are more inclined towards others. And it's just the way the human being is. Yeah. So therefore, to have that variety of people, it just helps and facilitates that initial, especially those initial 6 months. I mean, this the statistics that I've heard from the past, although I don't know about the current situation, when I was in the UK properly, like back in 2015, people would tell me that 40 to 50% of converts leave within 6 months. So that is a clear sign that the support from the wider community isn't there. And obviously, I mean, it is a long discussion. There's people like yourselves and others, mashallah, who have specialized within this area, mashallah, and are really taking, and you definitely know a lot more about it than myself, inshallah. The faqir, we're just trying to support people within that regard. And we're always there to try to help as much as we can. It's obviously one of the primary concerns for us here in the West. Yeah, and Zakman, hey, for those notes. Sheikh Omar Hussain, he also delivered another Dora in 2012 as well. He came and he did like a 10-day Dora on community leadership. We have some notes from that. What the Fakir will do is on the WhatsApp group, inshallah, we'll actually post some of those. So he delivered sessions every morning and evening on topics around community leadership. We're actually very, very relevant to this course, actually. So inshallah ta'ala, what we can do is we can start to post section on intention, another section on character traits like that. Slowly but surely, we can start to post things for people to be able to inshallah benefit from. Exactly. Salam. So, would you say success in all meanings of the word comes from being a problem solver? Resolving issues of creation, even financial success, comes from resolving problems as well. Yeah, we can say that. We can say that barakah is definitely key. Like the barakah of helping other people, like even financial success. But at the same time, you have to be careful about financial success, because financial success isn't always success. Now, the greatest tribulation of wealth is when you have it. Full stop. The greatest tribulation by a mile, by a long way, really, the greatest tribulation of wealth is when you have it. So financial success can often mean destruction for people. And they were forced safer when they never had money in their lives. So it's, and the Quran talks about we will take them by degrees, that we will give them worldly success so they think that they're safe, they think things are going, but they're not going well. And then they drag into the abyss. Allah protect us. Yeah? So we don't know really. So it's murky waters when you're talking about success. And this is one of the, if you look at Christian history, a bit of a diversion, an interesting point. If you look at Christian history, what happened with the Protestant Reformation? The Protestant from amongst the changes with the Protestant Reformation was they started to measure success by worldly criteria. So they said, for example, the Catholics would say whether you're poor or rich, that's got nothing to do with it. Like we say as Muslims, success is with Allah and in a different thing. The Protestants started to say, no, success, worldly success indicates otherworldly success. We don't say that. Rather the opposite, the fuqara and the people, the masakeen, will enter paradise 500 years before the rich. And the Prophet ﷺ would sit with them and love them and wanted, he said, may I live, die, and be raised with the masakeen. So really, financial success, barakah can't come in. Now, for example, this time now after Fajr, they say if you sit after Fajr and you do dhikr and you engage in the dhurus, increases your physical risk. And the time after Asr increases your spiritual risk. So it's there, it's definitely there. But it's, we wouldn't necessarily say that it's a measure. Yeah, suhbah is key, as mashallah Sayyidina Salih said that. Yeah, suhbah is key. Yeah, to have good companionship is mashallah. And you really see this when you're with people who are connected to Allah, that it enlivens the heart. Yeah, the best thing. Really to sit in a gathering with a salihin for an hour, for example, is better than, you know, like even like a year of optional worship. That's the reality of being in those gatherings, the secrets that are contained within those people, because they're examples for us that we can follow. Inshallah, we stop there. Apologies for overrunning. Inshallah, jazakumullah khairan, inshallah. And we leave this, it's open to people who want to take those valuable notes from Salih, inshallah. أفضل الله تعالى وصلى الله على سيدنا حبيبنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم الحمد لله رب العالمين